Whether you need some fun PCBs for the holidays or something more serious, head over to the PCBWay website and click on the PCB Instant Quote. Then you can select various types of PCBs and your PCB specifications. You can then select if you want the stencil mask and even the assembly service. Then click Calculate and simply place your order.
Hello YouTubers and welcome to this part 3 where we're going to take a look inside the Vicky VC8145. So just thanks very much. One of you sent me an email telling me that there was a name change. It went from Vicky to Vicky some time ago. So that is the official name of the company. Although, as I said, if you're looking for these meters, they sometimes have other branding. Now, to tell you the truth, as I was getting prepared for this video, I thought, well, it's not going to be that interesting because I already know from looking at the very nice written review of this meter online that it's basically an empty box inside. I don't think there's going to be much to show you. However, I was pleasantly surprised. This is one of those cases where the main data sheet for the main multimeter IC provides a ream of information in terms of how to use that IC to implement a multimeter. Basically, it describes all the functionality around it, which I don't think you'd normally see. And then obviously someone like Vicky go and buy this off the shelf, and then they implement their own code to extract the functionality they want from this IC. So we'll certainly have a look inside and see the bits and pieces, but I think the main interest is that data sheet. And I'll urge you, if you're half interested, to glean more information, because there's far too much to talk about just in this video, then go have a look at that data sheet. It's certainly a good education just to see how the circuitry around a multimeter hangs together, and they explain how, for instance, the analog to digital converters work, how you measure capacitance, how it's measuring currents, and all those kinds of things are detailed in this data sheet. But anyway, let's get to the bench and take a closer look. Okay then, so before we go inside, I do want to kind of tip my hat and say hats off to the gent. I'll provide the link here and below, who did the written review online, because that certainly helped with a fair bit of guidance, even for me. And I have a lot of respect. It takes a lot of time and effort to open up a meter, look inside it, look at its functionality, do a full review like I do with my videos, but have it all written up with all the details and photographs and what have you. So certainly hats off to that gent. But anyway, so getting into this, what you do in the bottom, there are four long screws. I've already removed them. You can see they're fairly long. So they are these ones here. These other ones obviously hold on these feet. These heads are slightly bigger than these heads. So if you're looking at it, just look for the screws with a bigger head. You can see they're obviously just going into plastic inside. I suppose we can't expect any more from something this price range. And now we can open up the lunchbox. So there we go. The top comes off nice and easily. Nothing attached to it. And then we get to the innards. Right, so once we get inside, we'll start from the back end where we've got power and some communications coming in. Let me just actually show you the back so it makes sense when we're looking inside. We've got our main power in, which is rated from 110, 120 to 220, 240. It's got the fuse built in over there. We've got our RS232 interface and our switch to switch between either 120 and 240, 100 to 220. So that is on that back plane over there. And if we take a look, we can see that the live of the AC connection comes in. It goes across the fuse, and that's where we've got our red wire coming out. That'll be our live. And then our neutral is coming in straight from the power point in there, not across the fuse. Those two then connect to a switch, and we've got a switch operated by a mechanical arm, which goes through to the front power switch on the front over here. So if I push that, you can see that mechanical arm switches the switch over here nicely. That then switches the power through to the board down here, and from the board it comes up and it goes into the selector switch. So here you're going to get your taps for your transformer, depending on what voltage you select. It comes through the transformer, and as you can see, it notes this is a 0, 110, 240. you've got the various wires for the taps, and your yellow is you're going to get your AC 9 volt out. Okay, so we've still got AC coming in here, and then I'm going to have to undo the bits and pieces here. On the one online, most of the circuitry is on the top, so the rectification and a voltage regulator. Here we can see we've got two filter capacitors, and I'm assuming obviously underneath we must have a bridge and a voltage regulator. So let me start with that. We then got a very obviously basic connector, the DB9 for the serial, which comes through to the front of the meter. So everything is stuck on here, a lot of big blank space. I'm going to talk about this blank space. Actually, there might be an interesting opportunity here. The front, I need to be careful. I haven't properly taken it off, but it literally lifts off with no screws. So there we go, it comes loose. I just need to be careful. I'm going to have to disconnect the physical link over here. So before I do that, this meter in the data sheet, and I noted on the display, has got a low battery warning built into it. So there might be an opportunity, if you wanted to perhaps make this portable, is you could set this up so that you tap off the 9 volt DC and have a battery system in here which charges off that, and that supplies the meter. It wouldn't be too complicated, and you've got loads of space and even points where you could actually screw mount things in here. Little battery which is charged via 9 volt, and you run the meter and you could potentially use it in a portable mode. You can throw your thoughts down there. I don't know if there's any misgivings about doing that, but anyway, let me disconnect this and then we can look on the underside of that and take off the front. Right, so I haven't done this before. I'm going to do it so that if you had your own meter and wanted to get into it, as long as you're happy to do that and risk if anything goes awry, it's on your head. This literally has got little clips. The power unclips over there. We've got some Celastic which is holding the 9 volt DC input to the actual main PCB. We've got the serial connector that simply unplugs, so that's not a problem there. We've then got this connector over here which is for our milliamp, yes, our milliamp input. That is on with Celastic. Okay, so there are some fun and games trying to get this out. There's a little nut over here which I've removed from this milliamp connector. So that releases that. That's straightforward. Put that carefully on the side. I'm struggling with the DC connector. I've tried cutting away the Celastic, but I've only got access to three sides of it. So I'm going to try and pull the board out, try and remove as much Celastic as I can, and then try and disconnect it. So that means removing some screws. The screws that I'm going to be removing are, I think, some go through to the actual connectors on the front. So your input jacks, that brings them through to the PCB. And then some actually hold, there's two PC boards which are held together. So let's see what we need to disconnect.
That's a voltage and resistance connector. It's coming. This is a 20 amp input.
There are various black screws holding the bottom PCB onto this front plate. So they have to come out next. Okay, so that loosens the top PCB. They've marked all the screws you need to get to with white arrows. I'm assuming some screws for the bottom PCB are hidden behind this. This has got a connector, so it's a bit tight. Aha, okay, so that all does come out. So there is the front plate with your rubberized buttons which go through to the board on this side. We've got the display. Just carefully put that down. Now I just need to disconnect this, and then I've got a better room to work with this. Okay, and I've just used a small knife to carefully slice around this and get the Celastic off. That was a little bit tricky, but that plug has eventually come out. I'm just looking at that. Have I pulled the... Yes, I did. That came while pulling that off. It actually raises plastic piece. But anyway, that's pushed down easily. So let's take a closer look. So here we go. This is obviously the main switch. And just on here, you can see there's a date of 2017-11-17. And then 8045. And then that must be a revision number, 3V0.4. I'm reading it upside down. Okay, then on the underside of this board is where we have these surface mount components as opposed to the through-hole components from the other revision. I say from the other gent who did the written based review, his board had through-hole components. We can see we've got the bridge rectifier here. That obviously takes the AC voltage and converts it to DC. We then have a 9-volt voltage regulator over here, and then that's going to come through, and we've obviously got the filtering capacitors on the top of the board, and then you'll get the clean 9-volt DC which goes to run the actual circuit itself. If I can do, I'll just insert a little picture here to show you what the original board is, obviously acknowledging the gent who did his written review, and I will add a link below. You'll see the through-hole components. And then just something else that I missed as I was opening this up, the latest date I've seen on this, unless you guys spot something else, is the 18th of November 2018 is the date on this. So somewhere around that point in time is obviously when this was actually put together. Right then, so to make it easier to kind of have a look at these, I don't want to damage the LCD display, I'm going to separate these. And then we'll have a look at what's going on at the top here. There's some interesting bits and pieces. So I think for the most part, this top board is the analog side. It's where all your analog signals are coming through. I'm going to have to get my soldering iron out and remove this can so we can see what's under there. And then I think the main brains is sitting on the digital side on the second board. So let's just carefully pull those apart. There we go. Okay, so we've got those separated. We can put this display down. So we'll have a look at this. Just out of interest, there's another date code here. So this PCB is dated 2016 and version 220.4, looking at that on the board. It's a very, I must say, it's a very nice clean display, as you'll have noted from part one and part two. Nice big digits. All this down the side here. Now when I start showing you the data sheet, you'll realize that all of these are the pinouts to the IC that runs this board. So the interesting thing here, these are clearly denoted what they are in that data sheet. These ones over here, you got 80, 0, 1, 2, 3. Those are for, if I remember correctly, it's either an input into the analog to digital converter, or it communicates with this to a microprocessor. I stand to be corrected. But all of these are brought out, they come up this connector, and they come to the top board over here and can be used as test points, which is quite interesting. So if you want to measure what's going on these pins of the IC, you can see quite clearly that they come from the main IC and come out over there. Very handy. So they come up and can be interrogated on the top of the board over here. Right, so let's look at the analog side of it first. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to start actually looking at the digital side or the digital board, because the analog side with the main IC on it is probably of the most interest. I'm giving you this top view. We're going to zoom in with my digital microscope to have a closer look at each of the ICs, but when it's the magnification is so close that you'll lose orientation of what's going on. So let's just have a look at this. This, just to again remind you, on the flip side is the LCD. So that is the display, and the main big IC in the middle here, and we'll see all the identification of these when we come in closer.
this is the main display driver. And as we can see, if we look at the IC, it's got all these pins going up over here, which connect to the actual LCD display itself. So that is that main driver. It also, as I believe, handles the RS-232 communications. So we've got this connector on the side here, which had the RS-232 ribbon cable coming in. These two ICs are optocouplers, so they provide isolation between the RS-232 and this digital board. So these come in, and that also is handled by this main IC over here. We've got another small IC over here, and this is an EEPROM. This might contain some calibration data, I'm not sure. I know the other gent who reviewed this assumed this might have calibration data. In the data sheet, I've read that potentially one of the values that the main IC needs can be drawn from memory. So that might be the case. I think this also acts as data storage because it can store data as it's recording values that you can read via the RS-232. So it actually has onboard storage. We've then got two 4 MHz crystal oscillators, presumably to drive each of these ICs. This IC over here is the microprocessor. So this has got, I think it's about 2K of programming space and 96 bytes of RAM. So not a large amount, but this is what Viki will run their code. So Viki, as you can see, it has pins going up to this connector here, which go up to the top board, which will interface with the main IC that runs a multimeter. But they're taking basically functionality from that off-the-shelf multimeter IC, and then their code is what is running to extract the functionality they want from that IC. So they've got that code running obviously quite efficiently because not a lot of space, and for that they're able to provide a fair bit of functionality in terms of the operations that are available on this multimeter that we've gone through in part one and part two. So this is certainly an important part of it, because this is what makes this meter a Viki meter, because they have got their own code running for their application of this IC. This IC over here is just a dual D-type flip-flop, so nothing big here, but the important ones here certainly are the microprocessor, the display driver, then we've got an EEPROM, and we've got the optocouplers. So this is that edge connector we're talking about, where the RS-232 comes through. Here you can see the optical coupling that comes from the RS-232. Just below that, we have got the EEPROM. And if you have a look, it's an Atmel chip, and there is the number H910. We've obviously got some supporting componentry, some capacitors. There's one of the crystal oscillators. Now we come, this is the main display driver and the one that handles the communication from the serial interface. So that's the FS-UP01, and this is -003. That is that main IC. You can see the controls going out to the pins which go up to the display above. We then have, and I'll just flip the orientation, that is the dual D type flip-flop. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure what functionality it's doing there. I'm sure someone watching this might know, so certainly post your comments below. And then just below that, we get to the main microprocessor. And this is the Holtec HT48R30A-1. From that, as I showed you, it does have the control lines which go through to the pin connector, which take it to the analog PCB which sits above it. And we'll take a closer look at that now. Okay, so now we get to the analog side of the board where we've got the inputs and the input protection and what have you. I'm gonna break this up into looking at that, and then we'll start looking at the ICs. Before we look at that, I'm going to insert, just part of the data sheet is a circuit diagram. So this isn't a circuit diagram specific to this multimeter, obviously. This is why this data sheet I find so interesting. They provided
a potential application of their IC by showing the surrounding componentry and how you could configure a multimeter. You can see from the input side on that circuit diagram, for instance, they've got milliamp and microamps, and this doesn't have microamps. But by having a look at that datasheet and the circuit diagram, you could see how the inputs are switched and potentially protected, and then how those inputs would then potentially end up going through to the main IC and how they're handled there. And they will even describe there the functionality in terms of how measurements are done, whether it's potentially measuring the voltage going through the analog to digital converter, or measuring how to measure a capacitor is noted in this data sheet. And that's why I think if you really want to gain value, further value from what I'm going to do here, do go have a look at this data sheet. Right, so just for orientation, we can see that this is where we had our inputs coming in. We've got our voltage input, obviously voltage, resistance. We've got our common over here, and then we've got our 20 amp over here. And this big hole is where the milliamp measurement is taken, because that housed its own little glass fuse. I showed you that in a previous video. Now, the interesting thing here is on the 20 amp input, we have a ceramic fuse rated for 13 amp. So why is it rated for 13 amp and yet it's supposed to handle 20? Well, if we do have a quick look at the front of the panel, if I can bring it into view and it comes into focus, you'll see that it actually says there 20 amp for 15 seconds max. So you're not meant to constantly measure 20 amp. This 13 amp fuse will last at least the 15 seconds if you want to do that measurement. However, here is the interesting thing, as I noted at the start of this video, in terms of the input protection, and that meters like this, even though they may claim a certain category rating and say they can handle up to 1000 volts, you should only use them for light electronics. Don't measure any high energy circuits or high voltage circuits with a meter like this. And this starts to become apparent when we look on the board here, and hopefully I've got it in view. You can see it states on the board here 13 amp 250 volt. So it doesn't really have a high voltage rating on it. We then do have a very nice current shunt, a 20 amp current shunt. So this will be a fairly low resistance value. And again, in that circuit diagram, when you look at the input, you'll be able to see where that current shunt is. Just another note on the input protection over here. We've got an MOV on the input protection side over here, potentially not the best of input protection. We'll just look at the other input protection. We've got some PTCs and some transistors which act as clamp transistors. We've got a couple of PTCs here, and we've got another couple of PTCs over here. So in comparison to proper industrial multimeters, which are meant to handle high energy measurements, this doesn't have the best input protection. So we've got that a nice 20 amp shunt over there. And then this is a 4 watt resistor over here. It does have a little diode which will act as some input protection for it over here. That will handle the milliamp input. We obviously don't have microamp input over here. We can see this cable over here coming to the board. I have to be careful, because that, if I wiggle it around too much, I think could snap off. You can see there's a marking on the board which says milliamp. Again, I'm going to bring you in closer once we start looking at the main ICs. Then next, we do have these relays. So these will be for the range selection, and some CMOS switches next to them. So that handles the range selection. Then these look to be like some potential custom resistors which are put in. These two black components over here, we can see one is noted as R5 and one as R4. I think these are two custom resistors. We then have these two trim pots. Now, as I noted, there potentially might be some calibration which is saved to the EEPROM. I noted that reading in the data sheet for this main IC, you can see it's got its 4 megahertz crystal over here. I know it, and we'll check closely. I think it might be around this part of the IC. I know it's got a reference Zener diode and the reference to actually for the ADC, I think is handled around this end. We'll have a closer look when we come in. And one of these pots, I think, is used to adjust the frequency for the ADC, and the other one is to adjust the frequency for the frequency counter or generator. So if we're lucky, we might be able to do some calibration on those. I'm going to attempt it at the end of this video. If I mess things up, c'est la vie, rather I mess it up than someone else does it. So I'm going to give that attempt later on. This is that very annoying buzzer, which you will have heard a lot of in the first part of the review. And then we've got the supporting componentry. So let us jump down to the digital microscope and have a closer look at some of the ICs here. Look up here to get more detail, and then down here, hopefully just to give you just a little point of reference. I know, sorry, the lighting is not the best. So on the board, so this is now the bottom part of the board. We've got some voltage regulators over here. We've got a 5-volt voltage regulator over here and a 6-volt voltage regulator over there. If we start moving towards the relays, we've got these CMOS switches, which are over here. You can see the references of them over there, HF4053B. Let's bring that into focus for you. The one thing I forgot to point out, which is a little bodge from the previous reviewer who did the online review, he certainly didn't have this component across the resistor and the capacitor over here. So this is a little bodge addition, which you can see they're holding on with Celastic. If you potentially know or understand what is being done here, then certainly post a comment down below. We've got our trim pots over there. We've got our main IC over here, which we're going to try and talk about in a little more detail. I'll try and trace some of the tracks and where it goes to. But before we get there, just to point out the other two important ICs over here, we've got a voltage reference. It's a 1.2 volt. I'll give the exact voltage reference, but this is the VREF, which is an important reference for the analog to digital converter. So the ADC is using this. Now, while I talk about the ADC, so the one interesting thing about this device and this IC, and I don't know how common this is on other multimeter ICs, but this has two analog to digital converters, and I think the mode of one of those can be switched into either a high resolution or a low resolution. So what is the reason or rationale for that? And again, this is something I hadn't realized before. So if you've got a high resolution analog to digital converter, that is going to run at a lower speed. The lower resolution analog to digital converter runs at a higher speed. So just think of it when you're looking at the front of the meter, and I might do an insert here just to give you a little hint. As you, let's say, measuring a voltage, your display is updating at a certain speed, but it's got higher resolution. But then look at the bar graph. That, you also need the analog to digital converter, but that you want to have working at a very high speed, but you don't need the resolution. So the low resolution, high speed ADC will be used to run the bar graph, and then obviously your high resolution, lower speed ADC will be used to run your main display, giving you the resolution that you want. On this meter, there's no switch to change the resolution like you do have on some meters, although I think this does have the capability to do that. Then the other interesting IC here is this AD737. So this does your RMS conversion to give you true RMS measurements, and you can see there are a few lines coming in over here on this IC. Okay, so having a look at the main IC, this is the FS9704B. Now, there are various versions of this, and it'll be noted in the datasheet as FS970X. You get a 50,000 count. The 04 is the 80,000 count version of this IC. Now, although you're seeing this up upside down, we can see the little dot over here. This is pin number one, going all the way up that way, and it is numbered around this way. So I'll give you a quick kind of overview. At the top of the IC, we see we've got the 4 megahertz crystal coming in over here. So we've got the crystal inputs at the top. I think they're pins 2 and 3. I think the voltage, VSS, I think the supply voltage comes in on pin 1. Then as we move along, we get an output that goes to the buzzer. So there is a frequency divider in here to give the correct frequency tone for that rather annoying buzzer. We then have the address lines. So we've got the 4-bit addressing, which if we follow through, those address lines come through. You can see them coming here, and you can see 80, 0, 1, 2, 3. And these, I think, are used to communicate with the microprocessor. So that is the addressing to communicate with the microprocessor, if I've got that correct. But those are sitting at the, coming into the top of the IC over there. We then have some various other controls to the IC. But then on this side over here is where we get our main inputs for our voltage measurement, the capacitance measurement. We get a resistor network coming in through these. And if I overlay that main circuit diagram, you'll see what I'm talking about. So our main inputs from the actual analog input, which goes through potentially various filtering or resistor networks, comes in through a series of these pins over here. The ones which I find interesting is we get the voltage reference input over here. So the AD reference comes in on this second pin from the bottom over here, which is actually pin number 31. So if we just follow that, that comes down to this region over here where we've got our 1.2 volt reference. So that goes in there. There's the Zener reference, which comes in on pin 33 over here. We then have the inputs for the RMS chip. So this AD737, there are several lines which come in across the pins over here for the RMS measurement. And then as I recall, some of these pins over here are various op amps, which again, I think support the AC to DC functionality. And then the last five pins of this are the ADC lines. Then there are various voltage and ground pins which are over here. Now the ones which are of interest besides those is an oscillator output. I believe if I'm right, it's around this one over here. So remember, you've got that function generator. So I believe that is what is controlled through that output over here. And then up here, these two pins is the frequency counter. So the frequency counter is done across the two pins over here. And then there's a V battery. I believe this measures if you've got a battery, and for the low voltage measurement, if I'm correct, is done on that pin over there. So that is the IC, which is, I say, an off-the-shelf IC. The pins which really interest me are obviously the ADC input over here, the reference for the ADC, which comes in on the side over here, and then you've got the communication to the microprocessor, which obviously is where the custom functionality, which Vicky code into that microprocessor to draw the functionality that they want from this IC. But as I've noted, I say that if you have a look at the full data sheet, I'm only showing you a little bit, you get a nice representation of the other supporting circuitry. You'll see in that data sheet, they also show how this interconnects to that IC which controls the LCD display. So the display driver is also shown on the data sheet. There's things like the clock. I mentioned there's a frequency divider. If I recall, they've got a 32768 frequency output as well, which would describe where you've got that clock functionality on the front of this multimeter. So they've got the exact clock pulse to do run a clock. And then they'll also explain how they measure, for instance, capacitors, how they will charge it up. And I think the reference voltage is 1.2 volts. And they'll time the time it takes for it to charge up and then for it to be discharged. And from that time, they can work out the capacity of the capacitor that you are measuring. So all in all, although a big empty box, it really is interesting to see how it all hangs together, because I say this datasheet does supply us with a lot of information.